thank you as always.
Thanks.
For more on Republicans' Faustian bargain, let's turn to Matty Doppler, senior fellow at the National Taxpayers Union, a conservative lobbying group, not a labor union, and MSNBC contributor Sam Seder, host of the Majority Report podcast. I guess, Matty, let me start with you, and I know you're a tax person and worked on tax issues. Mm-hmm. I guess the question that I have for conservatives is, like, what is it worth, tax reform, to you? Is Roy Moore worth it, basically?
All right, Chris. Well, as you said, I've been neck deep in the tax framework since its release yesterday, so I haven't been following every senator's response about
You sound Roy like Moore. A United States Senator and Sarah Huckabee Sanders, who all just have not gotten around to reading the Roy Moore clippings.
But here's the thing. I will dispute your characterization that Republicans are giving some warm, overwhelming bear hug to the senator that the entire establishment opposed in his primary. It's been 48 hours since he has become the Republican nominee for that race. So I would say there's been tepid, maybe, discussion about him, but this notion that he is somehow now the crown prince for the Republican Party is just simply laughable.
Well, I mean, just as point of fact, he was embraced by Ted Cruz, who welcomed him. Vice President Mike Pence had gushing words about him. The president called him a great guy and called him to congratulate him and also put him on Twitter. Cory Gardner, who runs, of course, the Republican senatorial campaign, said that he's happy to have him to make America great. I mean, so it's not, I'm not making this up. Now, maybe you think that they're not being truthful. And I guess the question for you, Sam, is, are they basically just faking it?
It doesn't matter.
Right.
I mean, look, this is the same story with Donald Trump, too, right? I mean, we saw the Republican establishment have big problems with Donald Trump until they thought this is going to be our way to repeal the Affordable Care Act. This is going to be our way to get a conservative Supreme Court. And this is going to be our way to finally get some type of tax reform overhaul that's going to last more than 10 years, permanent, like they did during the Reagan administration. Right. And I would add, just to the list that you made, Mike Pence worked with Roy Moore over 10 years ago on the Constitution Restoration Act, which said that Congress should fire judges that don't admit that our law is based on the word of God. So Mike Pence might have a little a sense of the background of Roy Moore. He didn't have to go back and check his quotes that he's had over those years.
Here's my other question to you, Matty. I get the sense, and all the Republicans I've talked to, it's like, this is it at the end of the rainbow. Like, they want this tax bill so badly. I've been hearing about it since the president was elected. The president went into a restaurant the night after he was elected and shook people's hands and said, I'm gonna cut your taxes at an expensive New York restaurant. How badly do Republicans on the Hill want this?
Chris, if you've only been hearing this since January, you haven't been listening to me for years, which is that tax reform is the number one priority for most people who believe in free enterprise and pro-growth economics. So I think that it's not really a radical departure for Republicans to get tax reform done. And I think that with the framework that was released yesterday, you're going to start to see a lot of pressure on Democrats, in particular the three that did not sign the Senate Democrats' letter saying they wouldn't support tax reform that didn't raise taxes on the rich. There's going to be a lot of difficult decisions for those Democrats, and Republicans, I think, are in a good space to move forward on the framework they released yesterday.
That I think, is a question. It's an open question. But one thing on the other side is, if we don't have all the details, but it's going to raise some people's taxes. And it's going to raise people's taxes who are some at the bottom of the scale and some in the upper middle class, some in the sort of like somewhere between the upper middle class and middle class?
Well, I mean, there were two things that struck me this week. One is you had Mnuchin and Gary Cohn both say on national television, well, we never promised that taxes wouldn't go up on middle class people. But look, this is going to be one of those situations where the details of the tax plan are fairly easy to understand. You've got $1.5 trillion worth of tax cuts that are going mostly to wealthy people. And, you know, there's another story here, and it starts and ends in Kansas. Now, they have taken Sam Brown back and they've jettisoned him into the ether. He's some type of ambassador to religion, I think, at this point, for the Trump administration. But the fact of the matter is, everything they're doing in Washington, everything they're proposing right now, was done. There was a 5-year experiment in Kansas. It destroyed the Kansas economy. It destroyed their educational system. This story is going to get out. So if they don't do this super quick, they're going to have a similar problem they had with the Affordable Care Act.
The problem, Matty, do you think that the Republicans are in a situation similar to the ACA? It struck me in the ACA, Republicans were trying to sell repeal and replace sort of on liberals' terms, right? So they were saying like lower premium, more coverage, even though the bill wasn't going to do that. And here you have Republicans saying, as opposed to making a supply side argument about why you have to cut taxes on capital and why people at the top of the income distribution need to pay less in taxes, they're making an argument fundamentally saying like, this is populist, this is not going to help people at the top, this is going to help people in the middle class, when the numbers aren't going to bear that out.
So I think it's interesting that both you and Sam somehow have been able to score a framework that none of the bean counters here in Washington have been able to do because there's not enough details. I don't think it's clear at all that this is not going to be a framework that doesn't deliver relief for the middle class and for lower income earners. I'll give you this, though. I do think in the framework it was interesting that it said the plan will be at least as progressive as the current tax code. That certainly is a departure from what we've seen in years past, but I do think that it also shows a learning curve for Republicans. It shows conservatives looking at the tax code and looking at what they want to accomplish and asking themselves, how do we communicate what these values are and how they impact real Americans? And I think we're with the framework, with the idea that this will actually deliver for average income earners, we've started to learn that.
Right. So, in terms of the scoring, people are taking a bunch of rough estimates because some of the details haven't been filled in. We'll have you back in the program when the actual data is there and the numbers. I'm confident that rich people will get a big tax cut. I'll be willing to bet we can make a donation to charity over it or something, which you're still going to be able to itemize, I hear.
Yes. Well, I mean, look, I'm just repeating what Mnuchin and Cohn said on national television. But, I mean, the bottom line is we know what happens when you get rid of the estate tax. Maybe they're not doing it.
Right.
We know what happens when you cut taxes on high-income earners. It doesn't spur the economic growth that we've been sold. We don't hear much of the Laffer curve that much unless you're on the a Fox News business channel anymore, because this has all been debunked. And so they have a problem. They're trying to make it about an easy form fitted on a postcard, but look, that's not really that much of an issue. Three levels of taxation versus seven,
right.
It's not that big of a deal.
All right, Maddie Doepler and Sam Seder, thank you both. Next,
thanks,
after his apology earlier today, the Tom Price private jet scam.